sitting in the morning sun. I'll be sitting when the evening comes, watching the ships roll in, and then I'll watch them roll away again. Yeah, I'm sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. Ooh, I'm just sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. I left my home in Georgia, headed for the Frisco Bay. I've had nothing to live for, and look like nothing's gonna come my way. So I'm just gonna sit on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. Ooh, I'm sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. Look like nothing's gonna change. Everything still remains the same. I can't do what 10 people tell me to do, so I guess I'll remain the same. Yes. Sitting here resting my bones, and this loneliness won't leave me alone. This 2,000 miles I roam, just to make this dock my home. Now I'm just gonna sit at the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. Ooh, I'm sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time.
My fellow Americans, as President and Commander-in-Chief, it is my duty to the American people to report that renewed hostile actions against United States ships on the high seas in the Gulf of Tonkin have today required me to order the military forces of the United States to take action in reply. The initial attack on the destroyer Maddox on August 2nd was repeated today by a number of hostile vessels attacking two U.S. destroyers with torpedoes.
I enlisted. I was originally, we were given a 4A classification once I graduated in 1966. But I decided to take a regular army versus being drafted. I was living in North Hartland, Vermont, just outside of White River Junction. I joined because basically I had no chance of going to any kind of school. And I felt that I needed a job, and working on a farm wasn't something I wanted to do the rest of my life. My first day was in Manchester, New Hampshire. We were all bused down there to take our induction physical, and then we went to Fort Dix, New Jersey the next day. And we were in basic training for 8 weeks, and we had to live with these guys, and we were in what we call Tango Company. And Tango Company was basically 135 to 140 men in one barracks, and we all had to take turns and showers at that time with 140 different people that you never knew. And you met all kinds, your haircut the first day, getting shaved bald, getting your uniforms, going through these lines that were just immensely long, and getting shots and fitted for clothing and boots and weapons. And it was quite a shock compared to what I'd been used to living in Vermont.
Did you agree with the war?
I did.
What was your opinion before and after the war?
In regards to my beliefs in it, I believe that we were doing the right thing. We were suppressing communism, and we were giving people the rights and the freedoms to have a choice. I disagreed with the way that we left Vietnam and letting it being taken back over by exactly what we'd spent 10 years for and lost 58,000 men. And I was stationed when I left in 1966 to go to Vietnam. We were stationed in Georgia first, and then we had 13 weeks of training before we went there. And by the time that was 1967 when we left to go, it was just, actually it was the 7th of July, 1967. And my first stop was Cameron Bay. My base was with the 1st Cavalry Division, which was sent in a place called Onkay, which is in the Central Highlands. And that's where we started out.
Arrows of neon and flashing marquees out on Main Street. Chicago, New York, Detroit, and it's all on the same street. Your typical city involved in a typical daydream. Hang it up and see what tomorrow brings.
Dallas, got a soft machine. Houston, too close to New Orleans. New York, got the ways and means and just won't let you be.
Combat for a year and a half. A year and a half before I was wounded. My first unit that I was attached to was the 1st of the 8th. We were 100 and my company was D Company, which was 100 and averaged 100 to 120 men strong, depending on who was sick and who wasn't sick. But out of the year that the rotation and out of total, we probably, I think the total number was 8 casualties during the year that I was there.
Oh, all right, I need a perimeter set up here, quick! Oh, man.
You guys, the first aid dress is ready. I don't have
they're up there, they're going to the hood. And dirty bastards.
Who's got
okay,
I need one for you. Sure.
Perimeter set up around us. Get another company in here!
You got a first aid kit.
Hey,
get him! If I got in the belly, you better get me in the belly first.
I'm all good excited.
If I not, just hey, another day in the now.
Well, other than being shot at, I guess probably was the most memorable experience for the first time. It was just something that you never realized something like that could ever happen, to hear a bullet go by you and knowing somebody's out there trying to kill you. I guess that's my most memorable experience. The devastation of what bombs could do and what war was all about, and seeing refugees, not knowing, you know, being in a third world country and seeing poverty, being used to having everything you ever wanted when you were growing up and seeing that these people had nothing except for the way of life that they were used to. And war changed all that for them. So I was wounded in November 16, 1968. In a place called Oshawa Valley. We were hit by mortars. My captain was killed that day, and I was wounded and medevaced out. That day, we lost, on that day, we lost 8 men that day and 24 wounded. Probably post-traumatic stress has been, you know, it's, as I say, the hard part about the war and everything is that we had to seclude it, and plus, back then, they really didn't know how to handle post-traumatic stress. And we had to deal with Agent Orange. We had to deal with all the stuff that they didn't know anything about. And I'd have to say, in the long term, we were, as I said earlier, we just had a tendency to go in a closet, and we didn't come out of the closet. We were pretty much loners. I think that was a long-term effect. We weren't. It was very hard to get close to other people. But I think in the long run, it's helped me better myself now that what I'm doing in this Veterans of Foreign Wars and doing what I can do to be sure that something like this doesn't happen to soldiers that, like I, when I fought in my war.
What we basically use it for on the LZ and I guess even out in the field too, if you want to know, is that we use the shotgun.
Drugs were very rampant. Marijuana was basically grown there. There was speed and LSD and heroin. It was mostly used back in the base camps or in the higher end camps, like probably Cameron and Tonsonute and Saigon, where they where they could get it more readily. It was much harder to get something like that out into the field, except for the marijuana was pretty local. I mean, it was just growing there, so it was just not something that was had to be shipped in. It was just go out and pick it, basically, is what they had to do.
Good morning, Vietnam. Our time is 19 minutes, 19 after 6 o'clock in the morning. We have all kinds of good music for everybody on this Dawn Buster for a Monday morning. Hope you'll come along and join us. This is your host, Army Specialist Kramer Has the Record Man.
How do people entertain themselves?
Well, back then, believe it or not, that's when the first part of the transistor radio came out. And that's one of the first things we ever had. And they had a radio station that said, every time we got on the radio, it was Good Morning Vietnam. And that's what they used to play. And they used to play the Beatles and, you know, that was the music. Music was most of the entertainment. And gambling was a lot of fun. We did a lot of card gambling when we had the chance. And drinking. We did a lot of that. Smoking cigarettes. And when we were on downtime. And there was a lot of downtime. There was as much downtime as there was in the field. I mean, when I say downtime, it was back at either your CP or wherever you were at the operations. I'd just like to say that for anybody that does view this, I just hope that they just remember that, you know, our war was not a pleasurable war, but we did what we had to do. And I know people that went to school and were supportive of the war, and I know people that were out getting high and doing their life and living their life. I came back a lot older than most of the people my age because of the experience that I went through. And I would just like to say that, you know, if you have a friend, or you know somebody that's going through a war or having come home from a war, take a minute and listen to them. I think it's important because they're not, you know, they may not say a lot, but you'll know what they're like when they come home because you've been with them before they went. And if they need help, talk to them. Try to get them help because it's out there. And that's what we're here for. The Veterans of Foreign Wars here. American Legions are here. The VA hospital system's here. Just get them help. And we're all brothers in some way, especially if they've served.